Welcome back in the API specification track. Really glad to be there with you again and with the whole API community. Now we will have as a speaker Kevin Danglas, CEO at Letiel. It's a co-op that knows a lot about the APIs. And he is also the creator of API platform, Vulkan and Mercure Protocol. And he will talk with us about edge-side APIs, how to build fast and reliable hypermedia APIs, a topic we've talked a lot at APIs conferences since 2012, but it was quite hard to make it happen. So maybe Kevin will deliver a solution to us. Hello, Kevin, how are you?
Hi, Mehdi, fine, and you? Thank you for the invitation. I'm very glad to be there today with you and everybody online.
Yeah, and just to say, hypermedia APIs has been a topic since 2012 at APIs conferences. It was hard to understand, sometimes hard to build, hard to have some tooling, but it seems you work on the topic. So I'll let you tell us for 50 minutes what you prepared, and let's have some discussion.
Yep, perfect. Thank you very much. So indeed, my goal today will be to explain that creating hypermedia API can be easier than before, and that actually it can be a good solution for your next API, especially if you were considering using more advanced and sometimes more complex things, such as GraphQL. So today we will speak about architecture, about patterns, not really about code, but at the end of the talk, I will show you some tools allowing to create what I call edge-side APIs, very easy. So my name is Kevin Danglas, Kevin because I come from the north of France, and it's a very common first name. If you are French, you know what I mean. And I'm the creator of the API platform framework that is an open source PHP and JavaScript framework, which is very popular, especially in France and in the PHP ecosystem. With API platform, I worked on a lot of topics regarding APIs. Basically, this tool allow you to build your API, then document your API, add some tests, hook some business logic, add advanced features like the authorization model, async API to display your changes in lives, and many, many things like that. And while building this framework, with the more than 700 contributors to this tool, we needed to implement a lot of features, and we tried to do it by following as close as possible the REST architectural style. And at some point, we also introduced another subsystem in this tool to implement GraphQL. And now we are at a point where we think that we can share what we learned by building API platform as a set of architectural constraints that can help any new project to be RESTful and to have all the benefits of the REST architecture. So I work at letiel.coop. This means the tree in English. And this is a professional services company. We can help you building your new API project or your new website or your new mobile application. We have several teams working with several programming languages and especially with JavaScript, PHP, and the Go programming language. And it's a kind of special company because this is a co-op. This means that the company belongs entirely to all the employees, that all the benefits are shared equally between all the employees at the end of the year, and that all the decisions are made in a democratic fashion. So for your next API project, drop us a mail. And if you want to work in a co-op, we are looking for new talented developers. So what's the state of the art regarding web APIs? Since 2000, the main architectural style that is used to build web APIs is REST. Basically, REST, which means representational state transfers, is all about designing a network, of linked web resources. That means that you will have a resource-oriented API, and you will expose resources, and these resources will have links together, and they will form a graph of data. And then, by using the links, you will be able to retrieve all the data that you need without knowing the shape of the API and the links between the data ahead of time. You will be able to discover that dynamically, and you will also be able to interact with this data. It's the main concept behind REST. REST has been designed to build the web itself. It's not an architectural style that is specific to APIs. Actually, it has been designed at the same time as the HTTP 1.1 specification. And it's also the architectural style of the web when you are browsing a web page. When you are clicking on a link in your web browser, you are using a REST application. And from the ground up, REST has been designed as a pattern to create distributed hypermedia systems. So what we call hypermedia is the system of graph of resourcing of resources that you can browse using links that I already described. REST has been designed for scalability, for performance, and for simplicity. It was the main goals of this architectural style. And to be able to reach these goals, REST define, actually it's basically a thesis that has been published by Roy Fiedling, and this text defines some constraints that a REST application, and especially a REST API, must follow. Basically, it's a client-server architecture. The API or your REST application should be stateless. To improve the performance, cache is at the core of the design, and the fastest way to serve a resource is to not serve it at all. If the resource is already available locally and stored in a cache, it will be faster than querying a server to retrieve it. And if it can be in an network intermediary, a reverse proxy, a cache HTTP server somewhere, it will be faster than querying the upstream server. And if you can prevent executing some code, some SQL queries and things like that, because it's already in cache, it will be also faster. REST is also designed as a layered system. To understand that, think about the Unix commands. Unix commands are a lot of small, tiny tools doing only one thing, but doing it well. And then you can use pipes, redirections, and things like that to build complex things, complex programs by using several commands. Actually, REST has been designed to be able to do that. As I was already saying, REST is the architectural style followed by the HTTP protocol. And when you are using HTTP, you can plug several tools together as small Unix commands to do something more complex. For instance, you can have your application server that will serve an application written in PHP or in Go or any programming language. And you can put on front of that another server that would add a TLS connection for HTTPS. And you can add a web application firewall, a cache reverse proxy, an authorization server, and you can reuse all these bricks that speak HTTP as some filters and leverage the layered system constraint of the REST architecture. Finally, the last interesting constraint that is in the REST architecture and that will be very useful for what I will talk about during this talk is the uniform interface. That means that only using relations, including in the resources that you will fetch from the server, you will be able to browse the graph of data and retrieve all the data that you need. That means that to be a true REST API, the API should be able to be used by any client without having to have something hard-coded about this API in the client itself. When you use a web browser, in the web browser, except if it's Google Chrome and that you are using a Google website, there is nothing hard-coded in the web browser related to the website that you will visit. If you go on Wikipedia, then the web browser is able to interact with Wikipedia and display everything that is served by Wikipedia automatically, just because there are a uniform interface and because it serves documents in a standard format, basically HTML. A REST API should be able to be used the same way, but by machine. There are a set of specifications published by the IETF and by the W3C defining what is the web platform. And the web platform is following the REST architecture. Among these standards, some very important ones are URI, the mechanism of identifiers of the web, including URLs, for instance, HTTP, the HTTP protocol to be able to retrieve and interact with resources, RDF, resource description format, the data model, the abstract data model of the web, JSON-LD, which is a flavor of JSON standardized by the W3C, allowing to serve, which is a serialization format of the RDF data model, and Hydra, which is a RDF vocabulary, often used with JSON-LD, allowing to describe all the capabilities of your web API. What are the resources that will be made available by this API? How can I interact with them? What are the properties of the resources, the type of these properties, the link between the resources, and many, many things like that. We also have, of course, GraphQL. GraphQL is a modern alternative to REST, designed to be flexible, to let the client hint what it will need, and to be able to retrieve in a single query what will be displayed on the client. So basically, this is something that is not following the REST architecture. It is using HTTP as a black box, but it's also an open format under the umbrella of the Linux Foundation, which is becoming more and more popular. But be aware that this format isn't using the platform. It is using HTTP as a black box. Since the release of the REST architecture, the web itself has changed a lot. So excuse me, there is a problem with my slides. The hidden slides are displayed. I don't know why. It's probably because of Hopin. Anyway, I will skip the slides that should be hidden. Sorry about that. So the first thing that has evolved a lot since the release of the REST architectural style are the standards themselves. Most of the standards I already listed have been published in the recent years. Yes, the slides are fine, but my slides that should be hidden are displayed, so it's a bit it's a bit annoying. Anyway, since when REST has been published, it has been published with the HTTP 1.1 protocol. Now we have two newer versions of HTTP, which are HTTP 2 and HTTP 3. Basically, they have been designed for one thing, to improve the performance of web applications and web APIs. And a lot of interesting features have been added to HTTP 2 and HTTP 3. The first one is the multiplexing, the ability to download many resources in parallel. So this basically makes GraphQL less interesting, because the main benefit of GraphQL is to be able to do a single query to retrieve everything that you need. That was very interesting with HTTP 1. But now that HTTP 2 and even HTTP 3 are deployed almost everywhere, are at least supported by most cloud providers and by all modern web browsers, this can be better to just send many requests in parallel and download many responses in parallel. Another improvement, these protocols are now binary protocols, so it's faster to download. Headers are now compressed and deduplicated. That means that if you send 10 requests to the server and you send 10 times the same HTTP header, for instance, the user agent header, actually, because of how the compression works, it will be sent only one time. There is also other interesting capabilities making the protocol faster, like support for prioritization. You can say that this resource must be downloaded before other resources because it is blocking for the rendering or things like that. There are a lot of improvements regarding TLS. And basically, for HTTP 3, TCP have been replaced by something designed especially for performance on mobile networks called QUIC. And QUIC fixes a lot of issues, including what we call the end-of-line blocking, that were making HTTP not that performant, especially on slow mobile networks. If you want to learn more about HTTP 2, you can watch my talk about HTTP 2 called Speed Up Your HTTP Apps with HTTP 2 on YouTube. And if you want to learn more about HTTP 3, Benoît Jacquemont did a talk about that at the AFUB Day conference. So take a look at this and you will learn everything that can be interesting regarding API performance with these new protocols. So, since the very beginning of the HTTP 1 protocol, HTTP 1.1, there is the ability to int clients and network intermediates to store some data in cache. So, here is a diagram explaining how it works. You can have browsers calling the web server directly without any cache. Then your request will follow the network, will go at the other part of the world, and will wait for the server to execute the code, run the SQL queries, and then the server will send back the response. You will have to make many kilometers, and you will get the response. There are also what we call shared cache. That means that you will have proxy servers or reverse proxy servers that can be closer from the user than the origin server. And this server will be able to store an HTTP response when it has been after it has been generated by the web server. So basically, the first user comes to your website, it hits the cache server. The data it requested isn't in cache, so the cache server calls the web server. The web server sends the response. It is stored in cache and sent to the user. If the same user or another user come back and ask for the same resource, then the web server sends back the resource directly from the cache, so it's faster and it can be closer from the end user. And finally, you have private cache. Basically, it's the browser cache, and it's not shared between users. But it means that if a user requests the same resource another time, it can be directly in his browser, and you can prevent the network request entirely. Since the very beginning of HTTP 1.1, you have some HTTP headers that you can use to configure the cache strategy of your HTTP resources. You have several strategies that are available. The expiration strategy, then you can hint the shared or the private cache that this response can be stored in cache for a small or a large amount of time. Some signals, for instance. You also have the validation strategy. Then, for this one, basically you can assign a version number to the resource using the etag HTTP header, or assign the last modification date to this resource. And if a cache already have a version of the requested resource, it will make a request to the server, tell the server, okay, I already have this version, or it will send the date of the existing resource in cache. And the server will be able to tell, okay, you have a version that has not changed since the first time, and it will send a 304 HTTP status code without any content in the body of the response, so it will be quick. Or if the resource has changed, then the server will send the new resource. You can mix an expiration strategy with a validation strategy. So if the data hasn't expired, the resource will be served directly from the cache. If it has expired, then the validation strategy will be triggered. Finally, some HTTP cache servers and providers, such as Cloudflare, for instance, and Varnish, the open source HTTP cache server, provide a more advanced strategy that is not standard and that can only work for shared cache. It's called the invalidation strategy. Here, this means that when the data change, when you receive a post, a put, or a delayed request, then you will collaborate with the cache server, and you will send the app server will send a request to the cache server to purge or to replace the current version in cache by the new one containing the new data. This one is very interesting, even if it's not standardized, because this allows to have the request served almost always from the cache with a long TTL, but to be sure that the data will never be stale because you will refresh it if the data changes. There are new directives that have been added to the cache control HTTP header that can be interesting for your APIs. First, you have the immutable directive. This means this resource will never change because the ID of the resource is the hash of the content. It's common for images, for instance, or things like that. And then all cache will store that forever, or at least while they don't need to reclaim some free space. You also, more interestingly, you also have the stale while revalidate header. This one is nice. This one provides a trade-off. Basically, it allows the cache to always serve or to serve for a configured amount of time a stale resource that is already in cache. So the user will get a stale data, but asynchronously in the background, after having served the stale resource to the user, the cache will make a new request to the server, and refresh the resource and get a new version of the resource. This means that you will serve sometimes stale data to the user, but instantly, so your app will be very, very fast. And in the background, why? Because you will refresh it, the next user will have a new version of the resource that probably will be fresh enough, or at least will be less stale as the previous one. So this one, you will see that in a few slides, is very interesting. There is also the stale if error new catch control directive that allows the cache to send to the user the stale data if the server is in error. So it's a way to make your API more reliable, because even if the application server is down, you will be able to send stale data. The software and the standards evolved a lot, but also the infrastructure. When HTTP 1.1 has been released, and the web was quite small. 20 years later, we built a lot of data centers. We added a lot of wire all over the world. The network is now huge. And there are providers allowing to use their servers that will be distributed all over the world. For instance, you can see the map of Cloudflare servers. They have servers almost everywhere. It's basically what we call a content delivery network, and now these tools are shipped to you. They are usually used to serve static files, basically images, videos, HTML pages, and things like that. The main benefit of CDN is that the servers will be as close as possible of end users. That means low response times, and that means reduced bandwidth usage. CDN are usually HTTP cache servers implementing the HTTP protocol itself, and so the REST architectural stack. But they are distributed HTTP cache servers. This means that the data will be replicated all over the world in all the servers, and it's handled for you automatically by these tools, these free software, or these services. For instance, you can use Fastly, Akamai, or Cloudflare. They work like that. You can also build your own CDN if you want to using distributed HTTP cache server. Distributed, again, this means that when you store a resource in the cache server, it must be propagated in all the data centers, on all the physical machines all over the world. To do so, you can use the Swan open source software, which is a plugin for the Kadi web server written in Go. It's a free software. Or you can use the paid version of Varnish. You will also need some tricks regarding DNS to be able to serve to the user to the resources coming from the closest server from his physical location. To do so, there are also nice open source software that you can use, like GeoDNS and PowerDNS. These platforms also allows to run code. It's quite new. Now, these providers allow you to execute the code of your application in a distributed fashion directly on the edge servers. So basically, it's similar to CDNs. But instead of just storing static files, if you are using Vercel or AWS, Lambda at Edge or Cloudflare workers, you will be able to run the code of your application directly right on the server that will be as close as possible from your end user. You can also use fly.io, for instance, to run in a distributed fashion all Docker containers. So you have two ways of using these tools. You can deploy your app on this kind of servers of this kind of providers and run your whole application in a distributed fashion at edge, or you can have a more easy to implement strategy, which is that you will have a centralized server and you will have an edge cache on top in front of it. And you will run some code, for instance, the authentication code in front of the cache. So for instance, this will allow to execute in a distributed fashion your authorization mechanism. So you will be able to be sure that the current user can access or cannot access this resource. And if it can access this resource, you will be able to fetch it in the cache of the server that will be as close as possible from the end user. And if it doesn't exist in cache, then you will call the centralized server. Both approaches work, of course. The distributed one is better, but also harder to implement. And guess what? The JavaScript ecosystem is leveraging these new features, these new standards, and this new infrastructure to make the web faster. And in JavaScript, there is a very popular architecture that is implemented by default by tools like Next.js or Nuxt.js, which are very popular in this ecosystem, called Jamstack. Jamstack is an architecture for front-end development. The main idea of Jamstack is to pre-generate the HTML pages that will be served by your website and to store it in a CDN. So basically, this means that when you will deploy your website, you will generate a static HTML file for all the pages served by your website, and then you will push these static files in a CDN. This means that when a user will request a web page, it will be served almost instantly because the page will be already in cache and you will not have to execute code at this spot and you will have all the benefits of a CDN. So it's good for performance and it's good for scalability. You just need to add more servers to serve more traffic. It's also good for reliability because it's a distributed network. So if one node is down, the website is still available. There are also more advanced generation strategies supported by modern JavaScript framework and especially Next.js. For instance, with Next.js, you have what we call incremental static regeneration. Sometimes it's not possible to generate all the web pages of the web page in the continuous integration system. So you will have to generate some pages on demand. It's what IIR is about. This means that when you will get the first request, the web page will be generated and stored in the CDN. This also allows faster build times, because you will not have to build all the application in one time, to prevent cache sundering effect, because you will be able to generate only some pages at some point, and you will not generate all the pages at the same moment. And this leverage, of course, edge computing platforms, and especially Vercel, because they are the creators of Next.js. This is very convenient to use with the stale while revalidate HTTP cache directive that I already presented. For instance, you can have the page in cache, serve the current version in cache, when the page will expire, you will still serve it from the cache, but in the background, asynchronously, you will let Next.js regenerating the page, and the next user will get the newer version. So let's see how we can learn from the front-end ecosystem in the API field. And let's introduce Edge-side APIs. Edge-side APIs are an architecture based on top of REST for building APIs. The main idea is the same as with Jamstack. The main idea is to pre-build as much API resources as possible. So basically, you will, using the server-side generation or the incremental static generation strategy generate the JSON documents or XML documents or any format served by your API, and you will store them in a CDA. If your API is too big to pre-generate everything, then you will execute some code at edge to generate the resources on demand and push them in a cache server. When the data will change, you will again regenerate the new version of the resource and push it in an edge server, in an edge set of servers. The benefits are the same as with Jamstack: performance, scalability, and reliability. ESA APIs can be written in any language, and it embraces the REST principles. The name is similar by design to ESI, Edge Side Includes, which is a very old technology for website, which is very interesting. And it's also the name of the European Space Agency, of course. So as for REST, we define some architectural constraints that must follow and that must respect Web API to be called ESA. The first one is that to an API to be ESA, you must pre-generate as much responses as possible. And you must store the resulting JSON documents in a CDN, in a cache server. When the API will receive a write request, a post, a put, a delete, a patch, then at this point, you will have to regenerate the HTTP responses corresponding to the updated resource and update the cache server to put in the cache server the new version of the resource. This means that when a user will request an API resource, it will be already in cache and it will be served instantly. Of course, for some resources, it's not possible. Some resources are very dynamic and cannot be pushed, cannot be stored in cache. So for these responses, you will leverage a distributed architecture and you will run the code itself at edge using something like fly.io or Vercel or Cloudflare Worker. So the benefits are performance, scalability, reliability, and less energy consumption. For this to work, you will have to do something that is very different as with GraphQL. Instead of building the biggest possible JSON documents, you will leverage HTTP multiplexing and try to have the highest cache hit ratio as possible. And to do so, you will serve small atomic documents. That means that you will not embed relations of a resource in the resource itself. It's what allows GraphQL. With ESA, you will have small documents with a lot of relations between them. And even more than that, if you have a big document, you will try to use one-to-one relations to split these big documents that will have to be invalidated often in a set of small documents linked together with one-to-one relations. This has a lot of benefits. First, the developer experience. It's easier to do that because it's just a set of small documents with links together than using things like GraphQL and building things like GraphQL parsers and things like that. You can just use JSON.parse and JSON.stringify in JavaScript and it will work. Basic tooling is enough. You will get a better browser cache hit rate and also a better cache hit rate on your CDN, because if the document contains less data, it will be less frequently invalidated or stale. Also, the clients will be able to fetch only what they need, as with GraphQL, because you have a lot of small documents, so you can fetch only what you need. And also, you can delay fetching what is not needed initially. So, if, for instance, you can make the request to fetch the relation only when it's needed, when the user click on the more button, for instance. And also, this will lead to less frequent regenerations and invalidations. You will invalidate less things less frequently. So, you will not do that anymore. A big document including everything that is needed by the client in a single HTTP response. You will do something simpler. You will use links everywhere. Here, I have a collection of event reservations. It's using JSON-LD and the Hydra format. Instead of embedding the items, the reservations documents in the collection, I will use links. So here, I have two links to my two reservations in this collection. And in the reservation, also, I have links to the related data. I have a link to get the person that who made the reservation, a link for the event related to the reservation, and a one-to-one link using a sub-resource to get the details of this reservation. So this means that this document is small, will be in cache for a lot of time, and if I don't want to display the details of the event client side, that's not an issue. That will not be downloaded initially. I will just have a new link to fetch it. This one deserves a world talk, so I will be quick about that. The idea is also that the API could work without specific tooling. So it must be able to embrace the modern capabilities provided by modern web browsers and modern web servers, like WebSocket, HTTP3, and things like that. But this must also be usable using simple scripts, using curl, using things like that. The API must be able to leverage all the advanced features if the client is supporting them, but you must also be able to use them very easily, regardless of the context, and fall back to HTTP1 without push and resource preloading and things like that, if needed. By speaking about resource preloading, even if HTTP2 and HTTP3 allows to, even if HTTP2 and HTTP3 allow to download resources in parallel using multiplexing, we still have a problem. If we are following the links like that, that means that initially, we will have to wait for the first response to discover the links and the relations between this response and the other resources that I need. And only at this point, I will be able to trigger the next request. So this will increase latency. To prevent that, I can use a feature that is supported by most modern web browsers and web clients, which is called preloading. This uses a special link HTTP header, and this can also use the 103 early ints experimental HTTP header or HTTP2 server push. The main ID will be able to get all the links of the resources that I will need along with the main HTTP response. To do so, I can use the Vulkan protocol that I'm proposing. The Vulkan protocol is a bit huge and has a lot of features. And I already made a talk during API Days dedicated to it. So watch the talk if you want all the details. But basically, it's using the new capabilities of the HTTP protocol, especially HTTP2 server push or the 103 early ints HTTP status code. And this allows, as with GraphQL, but by leveraging the web platform, the client to int the server of the relations that it will need. So for instance, here I fetch the book document And the client send a special HTTP header called preload, telling, OK, I will need the author and the reviews relation of this book. Of course, the client cannot guess ahead of time what will be the identifiers, the URLs of these related resources. But the server can, and a Vulkan-enabled server, and it's supported, for instance, by the Kadi web server, will send, as a response, the JSON document containing the book, but also some special link HTTP headers with all the links to the author and review documents. And so, the almost instantly, because it's sent almost immediately by the server, then the client can request all the other resources. And if they are already in cache, you have a very granular cache, then the request will not be made at all or will be made only to the shared cache. If you want to learn more about Vulkan and this protocol, take a look at my talks about it on YouTube. Finally, you have an opportunity in terms of user experience with these kinds of API. Remember, when you receive a write request, you will have to regenerate the JSON document containing corresponding to the updated resource and to push this new version in your cache server. Why not, at this point, also push the new version to all the currently connected users so they can have, without using any kind of polling or thing like that, they can have a UI that is always up to date. They can see every time that there is something changing. For instance, I get a post request and I have a user that is being one of my products and there is no more products in stock. Then I can take the opportunity to send a message to all the connected users currently browsing this product to display a message, okay, this isn't available anymore. So at the same time where I will regenerate the JSON document and push it in the cache, I can also push it to all the currently connected devices. To do so, you can use low-level stuff as WebSockets, WebSub, or server-sent events, but you can also use the Mercure protocol. The Mercure protocol is another of my projects. The main idea, it's a push system it's an hypermedia push system that has been designed to work with all technologies, including serverless, PHP, and other technologies not able to maintain persistent connections. The main idea is to delegate persistent connections to what we call the Mercure Hub. So all connected devices will maintain a persistent connection with the Mercure Hub. And it's supported out of the box because it's using server-sent events under the hood by all modern web browsers. Then when the data change, when you will update, when you will push the new version of your resource in the CDN, you will also push the new version of the JSON to the Mercure Hub. And the Mercure Hub will dispatch this new version to all the connected devices and the user will be notified instantly of the change. So if you want to learn more about Mercure, again, there are a lot of videos about that on YouTube and you can watch them. So, as a summary, what is edge-side APIs? Pre-generating resources as much as possible, using as small as possible resources, using atomic resources, being sure that even old clients or simple clients can use the API even if they don't support Mercure, Vulkan, and things like that. Preload as much resources as possible, but only the ones that are needed, as with GraphQL, and push in real time the changes to your end user. And then you have a modern, fast, and reliable REST API. This one should be skipped. If you want to do that, of course, this can be done with any programming language very easily. But you can also use in the PHP world the API platform framework. It's one of my projects, of course, and the new version that is being released, API version 3, has been designed from the ground up to follow the ESA architecture. There are also a lot of server-side tools that can help implement that, and especially the Kadi web server, which is written on Go, and which has modules very useful for ESA API, Swan, and a distributed HTTP cache server, a Mercure module to implement the Mercure protocol for real-time push, and the Vulkan module to implement client-driven resource preloading. In JavaScript, you have nice libraries allowing to deal with edge-side APIs too, so client-side API. Kitting, which is an hypermedia client for React and other libraries, which is very, very interesting. The SWR library from Vercel, the creator of Next.js. And there is a one that is not on my slide, which is new, but that it looks like it has been designed for edge-side APIs. It's called Remix. And Remix is a tool for React, leveraging style where we validate, and that works perfectly well with edge-side API. Thank you very much. And if you have any questions, we can discuss that, and we can also talk on Twitter about that.
Yes, I will ask everyone. Thank you very much, Kevin. I'll ask everyone if you have any question to ask them directly on Twitter. We reached the time allocated for the full presentation, but yes, it's really interesting to see, like, finally, we may have the tooling to make it happen, you know, and together like that, it finally automates, it makes sense. It makes sense.
And because of the changes in the web platform itself and each HTTP and the standards, now it's easy to do. And actually, the tooling is nice, but even without any tooling, just by leveraging the platform, the motto of the Remix JavaScript tools is use the web platform. And it could be the motto of edge-side APIs too. Now you can do things simpler just by using the new capabilities built right into the protocols, into the web platform itself, into the web browsers.
It seems the web has been well designed. Finally, thank you very much, Kevin.